On the eve of a crucial UN summit, we're going to talk about climate change. We all say it's such a huge issue, but we also know that audiences tend to tune out, so please bear with me, because it turns out that Canada is a major polluter. We are at the very top of the list when it comes to greenhouse gas emissions per capita. We emit more than any other G20 country. That's ahead of countries that include the United States. Basically, in Canada, we have a lot of big buildings that need a lot of power and heat. We also own a lot of cars. And a recent poll suggests a third of Canadians don't believe humans are responsible for climate change. Politicians around the world have noticed it's becoming very popular to oppose some of the actions meant to stop global warming. Earlier this month, the cover of Maclean's magazine featured Conservative leader Andrew Scheer and four provincial leaders fighting Trudeau's carbon price. And in Paris, of course, this weekend, more riots in the streets over increasing fuel prices there. Donald Trump, again, he's dismissing the latest climate warnings from his own government.
Yeah, I don't believe it. I don't believe it.
So what now? The world's power brokers are meeting in Poland today for the COP24 UN climate conference to try and move the dial a bit here. We've seen climate catastrophes striking across the globe lately, and a report from the UN last month said we have just 12 years to act before it's too late. The CBC's Nala Ayed is with us from that conference in Poland. So Nala, we get the sense the government, Canadian government, presents itself very much as a leader on fighting climate change. Is it seen that way by other world leaders there?
Well, Wendy, like other countries, Canada will be under pressure because of the fact that it has failed to meet its targets for cutting emissions, according to a UN report. And as you say, hanging over this meeting is the fact that science now shows us that what they agreed to back in Paris is actually not enough to mitigate the effects of climate change. So every country here, including Canada, will be under pressure to commit to more, to try to do things faster and sooner to try to mitigate the worst effects of climate change. In the meantime, the government, the Canadian government, says it will try to show leadership on a couple of fronts here. One is to end the use of coal. It's actually participating in an alliance to try to get more members here to try to push past the use of coal in every country possible. And the second way is on carbon pricing. You know, of course, it has not been smooth sailing on carbon pricing for Ottawa in Canada, with Ontario opposing using that way of fighting emissions. But here, there's a lot of interest in Canada's experience, so Canada will be sharing that. In the meantime, we're not expecting Canada to come to the table with any new ambitious targets for cutting emissions, but we do know we're told that the Canadian government wants to just commit to the targets that exist right now. And in the meantime, of course, there are a number of international and Canadian groups who are here who will be very interested in knowing how precisely Canada plans to do that, Wendy.
So much on the table. We'll be watching. Thank you so much, Nala.
It's a pleasure.
Nala Ayed at the COP24 summit in Katowice, Poland. So what is the federal government's record on climate change? Justin Trudeau campaigned on promises to tackle the issue.
It will undo the damage done by Mr. Harper and give to our children and grandchildren a country even more beautiful, sustainable, and prosperous than the one we have now.
3 years later, have the Liberals delivered?
It's time Canada put a price on carbon pollution.
One of their first promises back then was to put a price on pollution.
Here's the option I want to see on the table. Scrap your carbon tax.
Ontario, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, and New Brunswick don't have climate pricing plans which meet federal standards, and they're fighting Trudeau's plan to impose one.
Any proposal to get our resources to markets, it needs to do it in a way that gets public trust, that gets support from Aboriginal communities in partnership with them.
Then there's Trudeau's vow to restore the federal government's relationship with Aboriginal peoples on all issues, which includes the environment. A part of that is dealing with the Indigenous communities that pipelines run through. The Liberals approved the Trans Mountain Pipeline, but it's now on hold because the government didn't adequately consult with Indigenous people first. Trudeau has since ponied up $4.5 billion to eventually take over the build.
Today, with my signature, I give you our word that Canada's efforts will not cease.
That's a promise Trudeau made at the Paris climate talks. Only 6 months after taking power, he pledged to reduce greenhouse gas emissions to make sure the Earth doesn't warm by more than 1.5 degrees Celsius. So how's Canada doing on that? A study published in the journal Nature says if all governments had the same climate policies as Canada, global temperatures would increase between 3 and 5 degrees Celsius. That's more than double the limit set out in the Paris Agreement. In spite of all those outdoorsy PR moves, Trudeau's government hasn't quite hit its own marks when it comes to combating climate change. This month, three international climate reports specifically named Canada for failing to meet its goals. We're hardly the only country behind. But the UN found Canada's emissions actually increased in 2017 and confirmed we're not close to meeting our targets. Catherine McKenna is the Federal Minister of Environment and Climate Change. She's in Ottawa. So, Minister, nearly all of the reports are saying that even with a full implementation of your climate change plan, that you're not going to reach your goals and that overall emissions are not consistently going down.
When you look at our emissions, and we modeled this and we've reported this, that our emissions have gone down. And that a lot of the measures we've taken, so when we're talking about phasing out coal, or even as I gave the example, investing in light rail transit in Ottawa, it doesn't happen overnight. But yes, we have to be ambitious. Yes, we need to continue working hard. And it's not just about the federal government. It really is critically important that provinces step up and cities, because a lot of the emissions are, 40% within cities' control. We need provinces to understand that it can't be free to pollute, that you'll have more pollution.
A number of the premiers are not on board with your climate price plan. Is that a failure of your government? That was a big plank of your policy.
Look, I think it's really unfortunate that there are conservative politicians who think it should be free to pollute. When it's free to pollute, there will be more pollution.
But that's not what they're saying. They're saying that they're working out agreements with business stakeholders so that a plan that makes more sense.
It's almost 50% of the world that has a price on pollution. So China has a price on pollution, the European Union. When you look at California, it's the fifth largest economy in the world. It's got a price on pollution. Quebec is part of that market. British Columbia has been able to demonstrate that you can reduce emissions while you have a price on pollution and have a fast-growing clean tech sector. So we know what the solutions are. We know the solutions that make sense. And we now need to implement them. And we spent a year working with provinces and territories. As I say, it's really unfortunate that you see conservative politicians joining with the federal conservatives who have no climate plan.
It's all fine to blame the conservatives, but you've failed at getting a number of premiers on side with your carbon price plan. You've failed to actually lower emissions in the last year. A number of reports now are saying that your plan is not going to achieve the Paris Accord anywhere near it, and you're not alone in that. Canada's hardly alone in that. But at what point do you acknowledge your own failings in this? I mean, it almost seems now we're heading towards a federal election. Everyone's just yelling at each other. Canadians are stuck in the middle with this, and there aren't a lot of accomplishments to point to.
Look, I'm very proud of our record, putting a price on pollution across the country, phasing out coal, committing to 90% renewables
in
the electricity sector. But as I said, our emissions are going down. We need a lot of these policies are just coming into effect or are coming into effect over the next few years. This is a 2030 target that we have. I'm not in this for a fight. What I'm fighting for is our planet. We need to do this for our kids. We can do it. We can be smart. I don't want to fight. I actually just want us to get down to the business about being serious about climate action and working together and using the best tools that we know, including a price on pollution. We don't have time to have squabbles. We need to move forward together. And that's always my focus. But let me be clear, we can't just step back. For too long, too many politicians have done too little. That we are going to step up and do what Canadians expect as a responsible government and what we committed to.
We reached out to a number of Canadians across the country who have sort of specific concerns based on where they live and what their jobs are. And I want to share some of what they had to say with you. Here's the first one. It's Tina O.
low-income peoples are going to have the costs and burden of climate change on their shoulders through a multitude of ways. Those could be kind of water shortages or the increasing price of food. Housing could also be an issue as people flock more to higher levels of ground.
So, Tina, obviously, she's not a Kardashian. She can't hire a private firefighter. A lot of people can't if there's a fire around, if there's a flood and you live in a basement and you're flooded. How do you, as a government, try and impose measures to control emissions without those having consequences for low-income communities? She's saying they will be affected.
In terms of the cost, because I know people are saying, well, I don't understand, a price on pollution, won't that mean that it will cost more? For the provinces, we said to provinces, design your own plan, do what you want with the revenues, we just need a price on pollution. But where we've had to step in, we will be giving more money to residents of the province. So you will have more money in your pocket, and you also have the incentive, to take the bus. Or to reduce the heat in your house because you'll save even more. But we are very mindful. I am extremely mindful of vulnerable and marginalized populations. That's exactly why we need to act on climate change.
Got one more for you.
The biggest challenge as a farmer for me is going to be the carbon pricing, because agriculture is pretty much the only industry where we don't get to pass on that additional cost to our operation. So carbon pricing is going to be an extremely challenging bill for a lot of farmers to be able to deal with.
She can't raise the price of her grain or she'll be forced out of the market. So, like, maybe this explains why you've got all the prairie premiers basically saying, or most of them saying, we don't want a carbon price. How do you win over farmers like her?
And look, if anyone understands the impacts of climate change, it's farmers. Our system will give more money back to residents of that province than they will pay, and it will create the incentives for innovation. And I've seen amazing innovations in farming, for example. Zero-till agriculture, using less water, using smart technologies, artificial intelligence to, figure out how you can use less fertilizer, how you can, do a better job tilling, how you can get better results. We can all do this, but if we don't, the impact will be dire on farms. The impact will be dire on our Arctic. The impact will be dire on people who live in our communities, on the most vulnerable who live in buildings where, with extreme heat, they can't escape it, and people will die, as we saw this summer.
We'll see what's accomplished at the conference coming up this week. Thank you so much for speaking to us.
No, it's a pleasure. Thanks.